close packing, and I gave you some homework, so I will just give you the results. And if you didn't find this, maybe you can ask me after the course. So for the packing fraction, the packing fraction of the simple cubic is pi over 6. And so this is around 0.52. The packing fraction for the BCC is square root of 3 over 8 pi. So this is around 0.68. And finally, the packing fraction of the FCC is pi over 3 square root of 2, and this is around 0.74. So you indeed have that PFCC is larger than PBCC, which is larger than P simple cubic, which is what we expected, in particular based on the coordination number and from the fact that FCC is a closed packed structure, has the highest packing, 1/10 octane. Okay, so this is for the homework. Now I will continue and introduce the concept still on the crystal structure of unit cell. So the unit cell is defined for a given Bravais lattice, so requires a Bravais lattice. So unit cell, and we talk about the unit cell of a Bravais lattice. So the unit cell is defined as a region of space which, when translated by all Bravais lattice vectors, fills the whole space without overlap. So the unit cell is defined as a region of space which, when translated by all Bravais lattice vectors, fills the whole space without overlap. So this is the definition. So let's now look in two dimensions what it means. So I will take the example of a square lattice. So for a square lattice, I consider the primitive, the conventional primitive vectors E1 and E2. And, okay, I draw my Bravais lattice for the square lattice, which looks like this. Let's go one more.
Okay.
So this is the Vavé lattice of the square Vavé lattice. And now an example of unit cell. The most obvious is this, that is the region inside here, this square, is obviously, if I take this region and I translate it by all Bravais lattice vectors, I'm going to generate the whole space without overlap. So here I'm counting this region, and I'm excluding this in order not to count twice the same thing. So this is an example of unit cell. So now if I consider the Bravais lattice vectors the Bravais lattice vector of this simple cubic lattice, they are given by n1e1 plus n2e2. And I can define mathematically my region here as, so this is for any n1 and n2 integer. So my example here of unit cell consists of the region defined by all points P that are given by P is equal to x1 a1 plus x2 a2 with x1 and x2 between 0 and 1. So this defines my unit cell, all the points that are given by this correspond to my unit cell, okay? So this is considering the conventional primitive vector of the square lattice. But as we have seen before, there is an infinite choice of primitive lattices that generate the same Bravais lattice. So as we have seen, instead of considering this A1 and A2, I can, for instance, consider my A1 here and an A2 prime, that would be this vector, and here, if I use A2 prime, I generate with these two primitive vectors the region here, and also this region, if I translate it by all the Bravais lattice vector, generates the full space, the whole space without overlap. Okay? So I can also take a further example, like we had seen, of a primitive vector from my square lattice. And again, I could give an A2 double prime, for instance, taking this vector for A2 double prime, and I would again generate a region that would correspond to a unit cell. So there is also an infinite choice of unit cell for a given Bravais lattice. Okay? But this choice, of course, is the most symmetric and the simplest and the most convenient to describe the unit cell of the simple cubic Bravais lattice. Okay, and just for curiosity, if I draw, for instance, something like that. Is this a unit cell?
Yes.
Not very practical one, but it is also a unit cell. So, I mean, the choice is infinite. And, okay, so this is these are the unit cells, what one can have as unit cell for a square lattice. Now, there is one specific unit cell that is unique and has some special properties, which is called the Vignacide cell. So, a specific unit cell that is convenient. So the Vignacide cell. And this is defined as the region of space that is closer to a given point, lattice point, than to any other lattice point. So one chooses a lattice point, and the Vignacide cell is defined as the region of space that is closer to that point than to any other point of the lattice. So Vignacide cell, by definition, it is the region of space that is closer to a given lattice point than to any other lattice point. Okay, so this is the definition, and now if we look at our example of the square lattice, then if I want to construct the Vignacide cell about this point, the origin, let's say, then I need a region of space that is closer to that point than to any of its neighbor. So let's consider first this neighbor to my reference point. And since the region must be closer to this point than to this point, if I draw the bisecting line of the segment between these two points, this region must be on this side because it has to be closer to this point than to this point. Okay? So I know that my Vignacide region must be on this side of the bisecting line. Okay, so now I can consider another neighbor here, this one. And the argument is the same. If I take the segment and I take the bisecting line, this segment, the Wignerside region must be on this side because it's the region of the points that are closer to this lattice point than to this one. I mean, this region must be closer to this point than to this one, so it has to be on this side of the bisecting line. So I know that my Wignerside region must be on this side. And the same argument considering this neighbor. Again, I draw the bisecting line, and it has to be, the Wignerside cell has to be on this side of this bisecting line. And finally, same argument for this neighbor. If I draw the bisecting line, it has to be on this side to be closer to this point than to this point. Okay, so this is this square about the origin, centered on the origin, is the Wignerside cell. If I consider this second nearest neighbor to the origin, the constraint of being closer to this point than to this point doesn't restrict my region because the bisecting line is this one and my Wignerside is fully on this side of the bisecting line. So this the second nearest neighbor in this case don't restrict what I obtain just with the bisecting line from the first nearest neighbor. Okay, so this is the example of the, so it's uniquely defined. If one chooses a reference point, the Wignerside cell is uniquely defined, and it is a very symmetric object. Now, the first property, I will give you three properties of the Wignerside cell. And the first one is what I already stated, that the Wignerside cell is a unit cell. So it is a unit cell. It is a unit cell. So to prove it from the definition, one must show that by translating the Wignerside cell by all Bravais lattice vectors, one reaches any point in space. So to show this, let's consider a point, let's say, outside the Wignerside cell here, that is here in space, arbitrary point. Now, this point is closer to a specific Bravais lattice point than to any other point, and therefore it belongs to its Wignerside cell. And by translational symmetry of the Bravais lattice, it can be brought in the Wignerside cell of any other point in the lattice by translating by the vector that joins the two Bravais lattice points. So if I have a point in space anywhere, it's closer to a specific Bravais lattice point. It belongs to its Wignerside cell, and it can be translated by a translation symmetry, because of the translation symmetry of the Bravais lattice vector, in any Wignerside cell of any other point of the Bravais lattice. So any point in space can be reached, And there is no overlap because any point is closer to a unique Bravais lattice point in space. So there is no overlap either. So indeed, the Wignerside cell is a unit cell, the definition. Okay? Well, it's pretty. I mean, it derives basically from the translational invariance or the translational symmetry of the Bravais lattice vector. Now, it does not depend, the Wignerside cell, on the choice of the primitive lattice vector. This is clear from the definition, so it removes the arbitrariness of the choice of the primitive vector. It does not depend on the choice of the primitive lattice vectors, and in addition, it has the full symmetry of the Bravais lattice. By this, we mean that any symmetry operation that transforms the Bravais lattice into itself also transforms the Wignerside cell into itself. For instance, if I consider a mirror plane that is this plane, which transforms the ensemble of points of the Bravais lattice into themselves, it also transforms the Wignerside cell into itself. The same for the rotation, for instance, of 90 degrees, that would transform also the Bravais lattice point into themselves, I mean the Bravais lattice into itself. This point would go here, this point here. So the Bravais lattice is invariant by rotation of 90 degrees. It's also, this rotation of 90 degrees also transform the Wignerside cell into itself. So any symmetry operation, point group symmetry operation that transform the Bravais lattice into itself also transforms the Wignerside cell into itself. So it's a very symmetric object. Okay, so that was for the unit cell. I showed you the example for a square lattice. I would like to give you also another example in two dimensions, which is that of the triangular lattice. So, in the case of a triangular lattice, so still in two dimensions because it's easier to draw. Let's consider the triangular lattice. So the triangular lattice looks like this. So, so on. Now, if I want to draw the Venus side cell about this lattice point, I will do like in the case of the square lattice. I consider the first neighbor here. My region, my Venus side region, has to be on this side of the bisecting line, so I know that it's going to be on this side. Then I consider another neighbor here of my reference point, draw the bisecting line. I know the Wigner side region has to be on this side to be closer to this point than to this point. Same thing for this neighbor, bisecting line, and the region must be here. Again, bisecting line for this neighbor, considering this neighbor. The region has to be on this side, the Wigner side region. Then I consider this point, this neighbor. The region has to be here. And then I consider this neighbor, and the region has to be on this side. So from the bisecting line, the region I'm getting is this, which when designed properly is an hexagon. So the Wigner side cell of for the triangular lattice, Bravais lattice, is an hexagon. And the hexagon has also the full point group symmetry of the triangular lattice. If one rotates by 60 degrees, one recovers the Bravais lattice. And the Bravais lattice is invariant by rotation of 60 degrees, and also the Wigner side cell, the hexagon, transforms into itself. And the same for other symmetry operation, like for instance the reflection with respect to this plane, which transforms the Bravais lattice into itself, also transforms the Wigner side cell into itself. Okay, so it has the full symmetry of the Bravais lattice. So these were the examples for two dimensions. Now we are going to go to three dimensions, and there drawing becomes a little bit more difficult. So I'm going to also give you some picture and project them, because it becomes tough in three dimensions to draw things. So let's consider now two lattices, which are common lattices in nature, common Bravais lattices, the BCC lattice and the FCC lattice. Discuss the unit cell, and I will show you then also the Wigner side cell, the corresponding Wigner side cell. So now we are going to three dimensions. And we consider the BCC lattice. Any questions? It's okay? Sorry. Okay. BCC lattice. Okay, so let's try to draw things. So my BCC lattice. Okay. is my cube, my conventional cell, simple cubic, for the simple cubic Bravais lattice. And I will describe first my BCC lattice as a simple cubic lattice, Bravais lattice with two atoms in the basis. This is the atom at the center of the cube. So the BCC lattice can be described as a cubic Bravais lattice with two atoms in the basis. And the unit cell in this case corresponding to the cubic Bravais lattice is just this cube, which is the conventional natural unit cell. So if I use this description, then the possible corresponding unit cell, which is the natural one, obvious or more symmetric one, is the cubic unit cell with two atoms per cell. And this is what we will call the conventional unit cell. So it is the conventional unit cell. So, well, this is the conventional . Now, if I consider or use the description instead of the BCC Bravais lattice, and I look for the unit cell of the BCC Bravais lattice, then it's becoming more complicated. So if I use the description in terms of BCC Bravais lattice instead of cubic, with, for instance, as primitive vectors A0, 0, so my cube has a length, a segment with length A here, size A. A2 is equal to 0, A0, and A3 is equal to a over 2, a over 2, a over 2. So I'm using, did I put the green? As unit, as a primitive vector, I'm using a1, a2, and a3. So if I use these three primitive vectors, I can obtain a unit cell, which would be x1, a1, plus x2, a2, plus x3, a3, with x1, x2, and x3 between 0 and 1. And this unit cell will have as a basis the square here. I mean, this would be one of the sides. Then I have to add to all of these vectors, to all of these points in 3. So I'm going to go to something like, okay, let's start here. In here. Here, so I obtained something like this. Okay, and then I have also so this is the object, it has a side here like this, a top face like this, and then a side face like this. And this is in the back. So the unit cell is pretty complicated. It's not a very symmetric object. Okay? So this is the primitive cell, one of the primitive cells that is one can obtain for the BCC Bravais-Lattice. What I, this unit cell that I obtain from primitive vector of the BCC lattice, normally they have a complex shape. They are normally complex in terms of shape. So normally complex unit cell. So this is the case here. So it's difficult to describe it. One would like to have some more simple object. What it has as an advantage, it has just one atom in the unit cell. But the shape is complicated in general. Now, there is one specific unit cell of the BCC lattice which has a more symmetric shape and has one atom per unit cell, and it is the Wigner-Seitz cell. So now it becomes really too tough to draw, so I will project it. and I'm showing you soon. And I will also distribute it, since I cannot do it, if you can pass it. So I'm showing you the Wigner site cell that correspond to the BCC lattice, and then I will show you also for the FCC lattice. So the Wigner site cell is much more symmetric than this object that we have obtained here from some primitive vector. The Wigner site cell of the BCC lattice is actually a truncated octahedron. It has eight facets, hexagonal facets, which are facing the first nearest neighbor. So there are eight first nearest neighbor on the corner of the cube for the atom at the center. And the bisecting plane that now are giving the Wigner site cell an analogy to the segment in two dimension, the bisecting line in two dimension, are giving this facet, the hexagonal facet, and then there are also six square facets that are facing the second nearest neighbor. So there, the second nearest neighbor contributes in terms of reducing the region that one obtained from the with respect to the first nearest neighbor by using the bisecting plane. So this is what one obtained as Wigner site cell for the BCC lattice. It is a truncated octahedron. So for the BCC lattice, the Wigner site cell it is a truncated octahedron. It would be an octahedron without the contribution of the second nearest neighbor, without the six square facet, but with the contribution of the second nearest neighbor, it's a truncated octahedron. So as I mentioned, there are eight hexagonal facets. That are facing the nearest neighbors, and there are six square facets that are facing the second nearest neighbor. So this is for the BCC lattice. Okay? Now similarly for the FCC lattice, similarly for the FCC lattice, if I use the description of a cubic Ravel lattice, with four atoms in the basis. Then I obtain, using the conventional primitive vectors, the conventional unit cell, which is a cube with four atoms. In the unit cell, if I use instead as for my description directly an FCC Bravais lattice, the primitive vectors, typically those that I showed you previously, that point to the atom on the face of the, at the center of the faces of the cube, three faces of the cube. These primitive vectors give with x1, e1, x plus x2, e2, plus x3, e3, with the x between 0 and 1, will give a primitive unit cell with one atom per cell. But this object, this cell will not be symmetric at all, with angles different from 90 degrees, will not be a very simple object. So the primitive unit cell will not be symmetric. Simple. The unit, the Wigner site cell, and also one has many possibilities related to the many possibilities one has to choose the primitive vectors. The Wigner site cell instead is unique. More simple, more symmetric. The Wigner site cell, in the case of the FCC lattice, is this object on the right there. So this is called the rhombic dodecahedron. It has 12 rhombic faces that facets that face the first nearest neighbor. In the FCC lattice, there are 12 first nearest neighbor, and these are the bisecting plane that are going to that give the Wigner site cell. So, in the case of the FCC lattice, the Wigner site cell is a rhombic dodecahedron. It has 12 rhombic faces. Of rhombic facets that are facing the 12 nearest neighbor. And this Wigner site cell have the full symmetry, point group symmetry of the corresponding lattice, the BCC lattice of the, or the FCC lattice. One rotates around the C-axis by 90 degrees, one reobtains the Bravais lattice as well as the Wigner site cell, same for the reflection plane that transforms the Brahe lattice into itself. It transforms the bigness itself into itself, also in three dimensions. Okay, so these are the bigness itself of these two common lattices, the BCC lattice and the FCC lattice. Any question? It's clear? It makes sense? Now I'm going to some different concept, which is the reciprocal lattice. So this was the So now we are going to reciprocal space, that is, we consider a lattice that is more mathematical, the reciprocal lattice. But will be very useful for the description of electronic states. So, reciprocal lattice. So, we start from the Brahe lattice in real space. So, I'm considering so let's consider a Brahe lattice in real space. So the set of vectors or points are of my Brahe lattice. So I have a Brahe lattice here. And I consider now also plane waves. So I have a given Brahe lattice, and I'm considering plane waves. Which are functions f of r equal to exponential I j r. So this is the exponential, and these functions are periodic with a periodicity lambda along the direction of my g vector. So periodicity lambda given by the norm of my vector g is equal to 2 pi over lambda. So the plane waves, if I have a vector j, are objects or are functions that are periodic along this direction with a periodicity 2 pi over the norm of j. Okay? So I'm considering a Brahe lattice and plane waves. And now I'm asking the question, what are the J vector that make the plane wave having the full periodicity, full translational periodicity of my Brahe lattice vector? So I'm asking the question, what are the J vector? Such that my plane waves have the full periodicity of the gravitational vector, so that my function f of r equal to f of r plus capital R, where for any capital R that belongs to my brother lattice. So I'm asking this question, what are the J such that my plane wave reproduce, I have the full periodicity of the brother lattice. When I add a vector R from the brother lattice, I obtain the same value for a given R. So, mathematically this means exponential I J, excuse me, okay, exponential I J R is equal to exponential I J. G R plus capital R, and this means that exponential I J R is equal to 1. For any R belonging to the Bravais lattice. So exponential I G R is equal to 1 for any vector belonging to the Bravais lattice. So this means that my G times R is equal to 2 pi times an integer. So the the reciprocal Bravais lattice will be defined as the G vectors that fulfill this condition. So the reciprocal lattice of a given Bravais lattice will be defined as the set of vectors such that exponential I G times R is equal to 1 for any vector R belonging to the Bravais lattice. So this is the definition of a definition of the reciprocal lattice. So the set of J such that exponential IJR is equal to 1 for any R belonging to the Bravais lattice. So these are the vectors that will make the plane wave having the full periodicity of the Bravais lattice. Okay, so the first property that I would like to state concerning the reciprocal lattice, is that it is a grave lattice itself. So, the first property is that it is a grave lattice, the reciprocal lattice. And it is a grave lattice that is generated by some primitive vector which one can give. So it is a grave lattice which can be generated by the primitive vectors B1, B2, and B3, and I can give you these vectors given by, then there are two equivalent definition of this vector or formula for these vectors. The first one is that Bi times Aj is equal to 2 pi delta Ij. So from the A1, A2, A3, I can define the B1, B2, and B3 this way. Or equivalently, I can give you the expression from this B1, B2, and B3. So B1 is going to be 2 pi times A2 cross A3 divided by A1 times A2 cross A3. This is B1. And the other can be obtained by circular rotation of the indexes. So B2 is 2 pi A3 cross A1 divided by the same thing, which is because the cyclic permutation gives the same result. So I'm putting just A1 times A2 cross A3. And the last one, B3, is equal to 2 pi. Okay, it's a bit. Separate. It's equal to 2 pi A1 cross A2 divided by A1 times A2 cross A3. So they can be defined this way. So this is the second way of getting the B vectors, which is explicit in terms of the A1, A2, and A3. Now, it is clear that having this vector, one obtains this. So this is pretty straightforward. If I take B1, and I multiply by A2, since A2 cross A3 is perpendicular to A2, I will obtain zero. So, and the same, if I multiply B1 by A3, I will get zero. And if I multiply B1 by A1, I will obtain exactly 2 pi. So, in this direction, it's straightforward. The other, it gives exactly, I mean, it's a cyclic permutation, so one obtains exactly the, one can verify it exactly in the same way. So in this direction, it's straightforward. And now, in the other direction, it comes from unicity. That is, the vector, if I have three vectors, A1, A2, and A3, which are linearly independent, B1 must be perpendicular to A2 and A3. So it must be perpendicular to the plane defined by these two vectors, and therefore it's parallel to a unique axis, and it has a unique axis direction. Now, in addition, B1 times A1 must be equal to 2 pi. So this means that the given the direction of this B1, which is unique, I mean the axis, the sign is defined by this product because A1 times B1 gives 2 pi, so it has a unique possible direction and also a unique possible norm, I mean length, because of this this value is a unique scalar. So B1 is unique given A1, A2, and A3, and one can show the same for the other two vectors, and therefore that this is equivalent. That is, one can also, one has also this in the other direction, the implication. Okay, so now I just showed that one can use either this or this to get the B1, B2, and B3, it's equivalent. Now, in order to have a Bravais lattice, another condition is that the B1, B2, and B3 must be linearly independent. So B1, B2, and B3 must be are linearly independent. They must, otherwise I don't get the Bravais lattice. So they are linearly independent. And actually, one can show him by calculating the determinant of the matrix obtained by having in the first column B1, second column B2, and third column B3. So if I calculate the matrix, the determinant of the matrix obtained by these three vectors, in order to be linearly independent, the result must be different from zero. And actually, the result is 2 pi cubed divided by omega, where omega is the volume of the unit cell in real space. So A1 times A2 cross A3, and so it's clearly different from zero. And actually, I will ask you as homework to calculate this. So as homework, I will ask you to calculate this, which is actually B1 times B. Oh, oops, there is a mistake here. It should be 2. B1 times B2 plus B3. And this corresponds to the volume of the unit cell in reciprocal space, similarly to what we had in real space. So the homework is to calculate this volume of the reciprocal space unit cell. So to calculate B1 times B2 cross B3 to show that this is equal to 2 pi over omega 2 pi square cube divided by omega. And to do this, you can use this equality for cross product that you can find in mathematical math books, which is a convention, I mean, well-known result. A cross B cross C is equal to B times A times C minus C times A times B. So using this equality for cross product, you can show this to verify this. So as homework, I'm asking you to check this. Homework is to check basically that they are linearly independent, and in addition to even get the volume of the units and in reciprocal space. So this is the homework. Okay, so I'm assuming now that this is the correct result, and that the B1, B2, and B3 are linearly, therefore linearly independent. And now what remains to be shown, the statement is that the G vectors, which are given by M1, B1 plus M2, B2 plus M3 B3 for any M1, M2, M3 that are integers. So any G of this type are the only solution. The solution and the only solution of exponential I G R is equal to 1. So I have to prove this to show finally that my reciprocal lattice is a Bravais lattice, and this one can show that this is the case, indeed, if I write a G, G like, G vector like G1 times V1 plus G2 times V2 times G3 times V3. So any vector can always be written this way because I have a basis of three vectors which are linearly independent, and I take the G1, G2, and G3 as real numbers, so I can obtain any vector in space. So if I write it that way and I calculate the product, J times R, I need a capital. A vector of the Grave lattice. Okay, so if I write this vector the J in this way, then it verifies, it must verify and I impose that, that it must verify this, then with my vector here R that belong to the Grave lattice, that is that are n1 a1 plus n2 a2 plus n3 a3. So with R belonging to the Grave lattice, then if I, when I calculate this product, J times R, I obtain, I'm going to use here BI times AJ is equal to 2 pi delta IJ. So I'm going to obtain G1 times N1 and all the other terms, so this times this will give me this, and it's the only term that I will obtain because using this, B1 is perpendicular to A2 and A3, so it gives zero. So I will obtain just...
times 2 pi.
Yes. Okay. 2 pi. Okay. Plus D2 times N2 times J3 times N3. Okay? This is all I will obtain when I multiply this by this, because these are taken as the B1, B2, and B3, which by definition are perpendicular. B1 is perpendicular to A2 and A3, and so on. So this is the only thing that I will obtain. And so if my my vector J fulfills this condition, then this must be integer. And it must be integer for any N1, N2, and N3 integer. Because my R are from the Grave lattice, so it must be true for any N1, N2, N3 integer, and therefore I can take, for instance, N2 and N3 equal to 0, and then N1 equal to 1, and I obtain that the G1 must be an integer. So from here I obtain that G1, G2, and G3 must be integer. Okay? It must be true, this must be integer for any N1, N2, and N3 integer. So I can take as a specific case N2 and N3 0, and then I obtain automatically that the G1, G2, and G3 must be integers. So these are the only solution, and the only solution of this condition. Okay? So this implies that the G are vector of a Gravel lattice, or form a Gravel lattice. So the first statement we have checked it, that is the reciprocal lattice is a Gravel lattice. Now the second statement concerning the reciprocal lattice is that the reciprocal lattice the reciprocal lattice is the original Gravel lattice. So the condition for the corresponding R prime that the vector of the reciprocal lattice of the reciprocal lattice of a Gravel lattice are that they must fulfill I R prime times A is equal to 1 for any J equal to M1 B1 plus M2 B2 plus M3 B3 with M1, M2, and M3 integer. Well, this can be proven easily, the same way that I proved that the G are form a Gravel lattice vectors. That is, if I take a vector R, let's say R prime, and I write it in the most general form R1 times A1 plus R2 times A2 plus R3 times A3, and I impose exponential I R prime times J is equal to 1, then with the B1 or BI times A, J is equal to 2 pi delta I J, I obtain before that when I calculate the product R prime times J, I obtain 2 pi times R1 M1 plus R2 times M2 plus R3 times M3, and this must be equal to 2 pi integers, an integer for any M1, M2 and M3 integer, and therefore I obtain R1, R2 and R3 must be integer as I did before. I mean, the same argument holds when one consider the reciprocal of the reciprocal lattice. So in order to have this, I must have this product is equal to 2 pi integer, and therefore R1, R2, and R3 must be integer, and therefore I reobtain my initial Clavé lattice. Okay? So this implies, well, for any M1, M2, M3 integer, and this implies that R1, R2 and R3 must be integer. So these are the solution and the only solution of being the reciprocal lattice of the reciprocal lattice, and it's exactly the same original Gravé lattice. All right. Okay, so now to...
Sorry.
Yes?
Can I have a question? On the lower part of the blackboard, there is written like R1 times M1 plus R2 times M2. From that thing, assuming that M1, M2, and M3 are integers.
Yes.
We said that...
Any integer.
Yeah.
For so any integer.
For example, if M1 is equal to 3, R1 can equal to 1 over 3. The same can be generalized on R2, M2, and so on. So the R1, 2, and 3 do not have to be integers for that product to be equal to 2 pi times an integer.
Mm. No, because the condition for a given R1 must be fulfilled for any integer.
Yeah.
So not only 3, but also 1, and also 4, and also 6.
Okay.
So it's a tough constraint. Okay, now two more things. Statements. The statement that I want to make, which is going to be useful in practice, is for this Gravé lattices FCC, BCC, and simple cubic, the reciprocal lattice is. So for the FCC, the reciprocal lattice is the BCC lattice. For the BCC, the reciprocal lattice is the FCC lattice. And for the simple cubic, it is a simple cubic lattice. So as homework, an additional one for next week, I want you to prove the first part, the first thing here. So the homework is to verify this. And in order to verify this, I'm asking you to determine the BI. That is for the face center cubic lattice. You can take the A1, A2, and A3 face going to the center atom at the center of three of the faces, and like we saw, the A1, A2, and A3 of the FCC lattice. And I'm asking you to calculate the B, B1, B2, and B3. You have the formula to calculate it. And then you will see that indeed it forms three vectors that generate a BCC lattice. So this is what I'm asking. And the second thing is I want you also to check explicitly that if you calculate then the product B1 times B2 cross B3 with these three vectors that you will have obtained, you obtain 2π cube divided by the volume of the FCC unit cell. So this is the volume of the unit cell in reciprocal of the reciprocal lattice, volume unit cell in reciprocal lattice, and you should find that it's it gives 2π cube divided by the volume in real space. And now just to finish, since the reciprocal lattice is a Bravais lattice, everything we have seen for the Bravais lattice applies for the reciprocal lattice. We can define a unit cell, we can define the Wignerside cell, and the Wignerside cell of the reciprocal lattice has a name, and it's a very important quantity to describe. As we will see later on, the electronic state in a crystal, and it's called the Brillouin zone. So the Wignerside cell of the reciprocal lattice is called the Brillouin zone. And it's going to be an important quantity for us later on in the course, for the description of the electronic state after we have seen the Bloch theorem. So this is an important quantity, the Wignerside cell of the reciprocal lattice. So of the BCC and FCC lattice, the BCC lattice has as reciprocal lattice an FCC lattice, and the unit cell there is important to describe the electronic state of the BCC lattice, and so on. Okay. So I will stop here. If you have some question, please ask. Otherwise, we'll see each other next week. Okay.